Okay, thank you very much once again. So for those who don't know me, my name is Clement. I am currently a final year PhD student studying mathematics in the UK, Cardiff University, and I'm also a Vice Chancellor Scholar of the University. So this is our class. These are actually our third class on advanced data analysis using R. And the overall aim of this class is that we want to promote mathematical programming, specifically for among students from Africa, but anyone is also welcome to join. If you've not watched the previous videos, specifically the previous YouTube videos, the first two videos, I think you should stop and then watch the first two videos before you proceed with the third one, which is this current one. The main aim of today's lesson is basically to wrap up the first two lessons that we learned using some assignment tasks. So there are list of assignment questions we're given, and then so we aim to solve them, and everything would also be uploaded on YouTube. So please don't forget, if you've not subscribed, don't forget to subscribe to the YouTube channel. In a way, it helps to motivate as well as helps to also promote the class to other students. So don't forget to subscribe, share, and like the video as well. All right, so I'll share my screen. So I'll share my screen now. Okay. So basically, usually we use RStudio for the student. But I prefer to use Jupyter Notebook, which I've already explained the advantages and why I prefer Jupyter Notebook. But for the student, I will explain something shortly in the R Studio that I wish we get it once and for all. So some people were asking, so suppose you are doing those multiple plots, and what happens? How? Because everything I'm doing in Jupyter Notebook, you can literally just copy and paste into the R Studio and run, and you should be fine. So maybe I will share the R Studio for a short while and explain certain things shortly before I proceed with today's task. Bear with me. Okay, so I just wanted to explain certain few things, and then I'll come back. We'll go back to the main task for the day. So now I suppose this is how your RStudio view looks like. And there are instances where when you open the RStudio, you realize that there are some variables in your global environment. So as you can see, you can see some bin checks. So these are history of previous things I was doing. Usually you can clear this by just typing rm list equals ls with this bracket. I have saved it. I'll add it to your script. So don't worry, you don't have to memorize this, or you can even watch the video once again. And so running this one will just clear your global environment. So don't forget that this is used to remove variables, including those in history, those in history in terms of variables that you were working with previously, and then you open R for the first time and you saw everything there. You can just use this to clear the space. All right, so now I'm going to import our first script. So I just go to File, and I go to open file, and I select the folder I'm interested in. So the folder is on my desktop, and it is called data analysis. Okay, so I'm interested in selecting the first script, so I just click on it. So technically, this is how simple you can always import, as in you can always call a previous script. Okay, so without wasting time, so I've written the remove in bracket the list equals ls here for you. So clearly you can use that to clear your global environment. Okay, so don't forget that. All right, so let me just do something quick, and then so I'm setting the working directory now. So if you've not watched the previous two videos, please do well so that you wouldn't get lost. All right, so let me run this. So I click run. Okay, so I've set the working directory. And now because we've already installed the library called Moment, we don't need to install again using the install.packages or using the package, using the manual way, the package with the install and specifying and specifying the name of the package. We don't need to do that because at the moment we have already installed. So all we need to do is to run the package. So to run a package, you just highlight, it looks like my RStudio is undergoing some changes. So maybe I would come back to it. So what I wanted to explain basically is that when you come down in the previous lesson, we literally defined the BMI and then we did the BMI status. And then we're doing some multiple plots. If you remember, we're trying to plot sales graphs at the same time. Okay, the RStudio now, okay, it's working. All right, so the manual where you specify to install, you click on the package, or you can click install and then specify the package name, fine. So, and then keep in mind that because we have already installed a package called Moment, you don't need to install again, but always you will need to call, you load it using library. And don't forget, to install any package, you need an internet for the first time. So after installing, you need internet. And after installation, you don't need the internet anymore. So don't forget that. Okay, so my aim was just to run the multiple plots to see. So now let me load this package. So I've loaded the package called Moment, and then I have set the working directory already. So the working directory was set up there using this, okay? So, and then I'm calling, I've also imported the data called data_school. So any data name, you just have to specify your data name here that you've put in the repository, and then it should be fine. All right, so I'll skip these things and just come to, so for this, I can just highlight all and just run this one, okay? And then there are things I don't really need to show you because you already know. That's not my aim for with the RStudio. So where do I, okay, let me come down. Okay, fine. So here we also defined BMI as the weight divided by the square of the height. So, and then don't forget how we add additional variables. So you specify the new name, and then we're considering the quotient of the weight and then the square of the height. So basically that's what this did. And then we are good to go. So now we already have that. And then we're using the CAT function to actually categorize the variable, the continuous BMI into BMI status. So that's basically what we did. So you just highlight and you run. Okay, so this is where I wanted to. So in Jupyter Notebook, you realize that I also specify MF row. 3x2 here means that I want my plots to be on 6 rows and 2 columns, okay? And then this margin here is just to give a wider space, okay? So you can highlight, and then, so meaning that I want to plot sales graphs, and clearly this is the first plot. The second plot is here, as you can see. The third plot is here, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth. So all you need to do in RStudio is to highlight everything up to the last point, okay? Up to what you want, and just run. So everything will do the same thing, and you can see all your plots at this side, okay? And to export this one, you can just click on export, then save as image, give any name you want to give to it. So suppose you want to call it combined plots, you just specify combined plots, anyhow you want to label it. And don't forget that once you click save, it automatically goes to your repository, okay? And then, so it automatically goes to your repository. So because you realize that we've already set the working directory. So once we click save, it automatically goes to this directory, data analysis _R, okay? So don't forget that. So this is what I just wanted to show you, that everything I'm doing in Jupyter Notebook, you can technically do it in R, but make sure you highlight everything. And one thing that someone also, a mistake that someone was pointing out today was when I was writing the previous data, I think here I used in the summary statistics function, I used it. It's here. So here I use school_data. Meanwhile, I wanted to define it to be general so that it will pick any data. So all I needed to use is to changes to data, and also changes to data, okay? Because if you specify it to be data_school here, and then you use a different data with a different name, you will not get results for this part, okay? Because and basically we just wanted to generalize, so you needed to use the data name. Okay, fine. So that, don't forget that. Okay. So that's just what I wanted to show with the RStudio for now. So we are switching to Jupyter Notebook. So yeah. So what I was saying was the summary statistics function is actually from here up to this side. Okay. So don't forget, if you run and you ignore the last curly bracket here, you are definitely going to get an error. Okay, let's see what happens. So suppose I was running, and how would you know where the summary statistics ends? So this is the last curly bracket. If I click at the last one and I come up, you will see that this curly bracket has been highlighted. It tells you that that is actually, this is the beginning and that is the end, okay? So now suppose I highlight this and I forget the last, suppose I highlight this and I forget the last curly bracket, I forgot this last one, and I run, let's see what happens. So when I run, you realize that there's a plus sign here, which indicates that it's not complete. So even if I add the remaining one to it and I run, it will still not be complete. So all you can do is you click here and press escape to stop it, okay? So always make sure when you are running such big functions you've created, or huge functions or very long functions, highlight everything up to where it needs to end before you run. And in that case, you wouldn't have that error or that, because it wasn't ending anyway. So keep that in mind. All right, so I'll stop sharing here and go to Jupyter Notebook. Okay, fine. All right, so we just wrap up faster and then make sure we speed up a little bit for today. So the assignment was basically, first of all, to apply what we've learned previously in the first two lessons. Okay, so we are just wrapping up. So there was a data called university_data. So it's actually a data obtained from, is it Hungary? Yes. And then so these are the description of the variables. So the variables we are going to be working with in relation to this data, the first variable, which is major, is actually the program major of freshmen. The language, because they use two languages, either Hungarian language or English. The type was representing the type of scholarship, the type of scholarship. And the enrollment point, so suppose each student is enrolled, there's a specific point over 500 that is given to each student, okay? And then the next one was high level of mathematics. So do you have, does the student has high level or not? So it was a yes or no variable here. And then the mathematics point is more like their scores in mathematics over 100%. And then the last one was, this last one is actually something I added. So there wasn't anything like this to the original data. I added it. So there's a variable called residence. So I randomly chose one to represent South, two to represent North, and so on. Okay, fine. So these were the specific tasks. So if you are new to these questions, so basically in our previous lesson, there was a specific task given to the student for them to wrap up what we've learned. So if you're not part of the class, you might not be able to have direct access because if you are not signed up to Piazza yet. So, but if you need a class, you can always contact. If you need a question, you can always contact me for it. Or just watch the YouTube video and you should be fine. So the first question was, let's assign names to the levels of the category. So there's a variable called residence. It has been coded as 1, 2, 3, 4, okay? And then R doesn't know that 1 stands for South, 2 stand for North, 3 stand for East, and 4 stand for West. And keep in mind, if you code your variables as such in your data, and import it, R will not know that the variable residence is categorical if you actually coded it as 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so it's left with you to tell R that it's indeed categorical, and if it's categorical, these are the specific names for the categories. And the next thing was to create a numerical variable called total point. And for this total point, all we needed to do was to sum the enrollment points and also the mathematics points. Okay, so this is also another variable I just added. It wasn't part of the original data. So now we want to be able to now Fine. So this is the essence of this second part, is just for you to know that you can always create additional variables based on existing ones, okay? And then the next one was to convert the mathematics points. For this, I added it today. It wasn't part of the previous assignment task. So now we want to be able to convert the numerical or quantitative variable of mathematics points. We want to convert it to something categorical, okay? And we will name it as mathematics grade. And then the categories will be low class if the mathematics point is less than 40, medium class if the mathematics point is from 40 to 70, and then I am high class if mathematics point is greater than 70. So the essence of this one is just to be able to help to convert numerical variables or something numerical to categorical when they need be. So keep in mind that if your data is already numeric, like DNI, BMI, or let's say height or weight, and you want to categorize it, always you can do that easily in R as well. And the next thing was to save our new data, because now don't forget we've added two new variables. First of all, we've assigned the names to the resident variable. We've also computed something for total points. And then we've also added a variable called mathematics grades. So afterwards, we want to know how we can save this data. Suppose you want to save it and use it in some future time, okay? So that you wouldn't have to go through the first three steps anymore because you've already done the job, okay? So how would we save it? So we look at that. And then the next one was to create. So this is one of the most important thing that actually is also the most complicated thing so far in what we've done so far. So that this fifth one is to create a summary statistics function. And previously in the first, if you watch the first two videos, you realize that we were able to create a summary statistics function to first of all pick a data. And when it picks a data, it asks each variable, is it numerical or categorical? If it is numerical, it was computing the mean, median, mode, the mean, median, the standard deviation, the standard error, and then the skewness and ketosis. And then it should plot histogram as well. That is if it is what numerical or quantitative. But if it was categorical, all what it was doing previously was that it was computing the percentages and then returning the output of the percentages and the categories, their respective categories, okay? Now we wanted to make it even much more complicated. And the essence is that you can actually create your own function to do any task you want, okay? And this function we've done is like an automated function so that it can pick, you can use it for any data you already have or any data you get in some future time, okay? So now what we've now done is that if it is numerical, first of all, we are computing the mean, the median, the mode, the variance, standard deviation, maximum, minimum, standard error, skewness, ketosis, and even 95% quantiles, okay? And then we are recording that to the smart places. And then it should plot histogram as well. So all you just need to do is that once you specify the variable and it's numerical, it will do all these things for you. And then the next one is if it is categorical, now it should return the percentages for each category. And then it should also plot a pie chart. Okay. And then with the pie chart, it should also paste the percentages of each of the categories on it with different colors. So this is how complicated today's function for the summary statistics will be. And we can actually write a package around this so that people can use it for their studies. And you can actually use it for any of your studies. You don't need to create your new functions anymore. But keep in mind, in reality, you wouldn't want to compute for when it's numerical, you wouldn't want to compute everything I've written here. You wouldn't want to compute the median, the mean, the median, the mode, the variance, the standard deviation, maximum, minimum, standard error, skewness, ketosis, and then quantiles, okay? You would want to choose what is relevant. So mode, if you look at mode as a central tendency, okay? So I'm doing some bit of teaching aside the programming. So if you look at the mode as a central tendency, it's just looking at which particular number, okay, or variable, okay, or category, if it is categorical, appeared most frequently, okay? So you can actually find the mode for a categorical variable as well. And there are instances the mode for categorical variable can be very useful, especially when you are dealing with branding. So suppose that there are a lot of, let's say, minerals or some brands, and we want to know which one is the best. don't you think that we cannot find a mean for that because it's a categorical variable? Suppose that we have different brands and want to know which one is the best. You're finding mean of that is it doesn't make sense because the variable is categorical, isn't it? And then finding median will not also make sense. The mode will make sense in that case. In that regard, it meant that we are looking for which brand did people choose more. Okay, so in essence, which brand appeared more frequently means that which brand did people opt for. So sometimes the mode can even be useful depending on the type of variable you want to summarize if it's categorical. There are instances for numerical, the mode might not be useful. There are instances the mode can also might not even exist. Suppose that all the numbers, the unique numbers are appearing at the same rate. Or there are instances where, let's say, 10 variables are appearing at the same frequency. So in that case, it means the mode can be any of the 10, okay? And that will not be very useful to you. So keep in mind that this is just for the programming side. When you are doing real life analysis, maybe I would want to go for the median, the mean and the median helps, especially if the data has some level of skewness. So the difference between the median and the mean will tell us a little bit also about the distribution. Don't forget that if the data is not normally distributed, okay, or if the data is very skewed or there are a lot of outliers, we expect, and the outliers, depending on whether the outliers is smaller or large, the mean can be either less than the median or can be greater than the median, depending on whether it's less or large, okay, when the outliers are less or large. But keep in mind that when the data is relatively normal, we expect the mean, the median, and the mean to be almost the same. Almost the same, that didn't mean equality, okay? But if they are close enough, it also gives you a fair idea that there might not be outliers in the data that much because the median is not affected by outliers. And if the median value and the mean are almost similar, then it gives you a fair idea, even though you need to do an actual statistical test to confirm whether the data is normally distributed or not. So keep in mind, and if I find the variance, and then I would always have to choose between the variance and the standard deviation. And I think I'll go for the standard deviation over the variance. So you wouldn't want to report on variance and standard deviation in the same study. It wouldn't really make sense because the variance is just the square of the standard deviation. And the standard deviation is just the square root of the variance. The maximum and the minimum, okay, can be useful sometimes. The standard error is just the standard deviation divided by square root of the sample size. The standard error is useful if you want to estimate confidence intervals. So if you wanted to estimate confidence interval, it would have been the mean here plus or minus some critical value times this standard error. So you can actually also even estimate confidence intervals, add confidence intervals as part of your summary statistics. Okay, because now we've been exposed and we can do anything we want. All right. And the quantas might not be very useful for some studies, and then it can be useful for others. Okay, so it always depends on what you really want. And then you define the functions to do those specific tasks for you, okay? All right, and don't forget that with the histogram plot, now I want us to get, was it a green color? You can change the color. I think I later change it to blue, okay? So any color you want, fine. And then the next one was to find for each variable, find the summary statistics. And don't forget that now we've automated the function up here. So it means that suppose you have a new data set, you don't even know the variables, okay? You don't even know the names of the variables, but we know how to find the names of the variables. We just have to type names around the data, okay? But suppose you don't even know the names of the variables. Once you just use our function, and then you specify, you put the data, you specify the name of the data, then you specify maybe you want summary statistics for the first column. You don't have to care whether the first column is numerical or not. Our function will do that for you, okay? Because we've made it automated so that if it is numerical, it will do some specific things with a plot. And now if it is categorical, it will do also find percentages and then even add pie charts as well. And then the next thing was to also help us. So keep in mind in R, there are two ways of actually getting professional plots. We have base functions for plotting in R. So there are specific plots that you don't even need packages, okay? And you can plot without packages. But there are customized packages as well that can help us to get more customized plots. And then one of the most customized packages for plotting is ggplot2. So this ggplot2 is very, very useful. And if you are someone who does Python programming as well, ggplot2 is nothing but very close to something like matplotlib. If you program in Python, there's a package called matplotlib, and that package also helps you tremendously to get plots that looks like ggplot2. So don't forget that ggplot2 helps us to get customized plots. Okay, so you can plot with a pack with the help of a package, and you can actually plot using the base R without any package. So that was for the eighth task. And I think I wouldn't go much about the eighth task, the one without a package, because we already have in our previous lessons, we did that. And maybe I'll try one or two, but we wouldn't go much, but I'll emphasize more on the ggplot because it's something useful that I would want to reemphasize. And the last one is to obtain something called a correlation matrix plot using a package called performance analytics. R without a package has a particular function called pairs that actually helps you to get correlation matrix plots. But the advantage of the performance analytics is that, first of all, it gives you the correlation matrix plot with three different information. The main diagonal is actually histogram plots of the variables. And then in the off diagonal, the upper diagonal is just the Pearson correlation with its significance attached to it, okay? And then at the lower half of the matrix is, I'm talking about the lower diagonal, then we have what you call the scatter plots, okay? So the performance analytics plot is really customized. It tells you a lot of information if you want to explore correlation of numerical variables. And don't forget, you cannot find Pearson correlation if the variables are categorical. You can only find correlation among numerical variables, okay? If it is categorical, that is when you would want to do what? You would want to find, you would want to find a chi-square. But there are instances you will be interested in looking at the relationship between a numerical variable and a categorical. So we said numerical, one can just go for, specifically when it's continuous, one can just go for a Pearson correlation. Suppose the variable wasn't very continuous and normally distributed, then one can go for non-parametric tests like Spearman rank or Kendall tau. Is also a correlation coefficient value that you can also get if the data is not strictly normally distributed, okay? We'll go into this in detail in subsequent lesson, but I just want to give you a fair idea. So we are learning statistics a little bit as well as we are doing some programming, because they actually go in unity. You cannot do the programming if you don't understand the statistics behind it. Why? Because for the programming, whatever you do, you get an output. But as to whether your output is, you are doing the right thing, you really need to also understand your statistics behind it. But situations where you want to look at the relationship between a numerical variable and a categorical, that is when regression models can help in that sense, okay? So keep that in mind. We'll be doing those inferential statistics later. All right, so without wasting time now, I've already coded the functions. So all we will do is that we are going through the functions, and then I would explain where necessary. We already know how to set a working directory. So all I need to do is to run this. So now I've set the working directory. And then I told you that in Jupyter Notebook, okay, for Jupyter Notebook, very soon you would all switch from RStudio, because I'm sure you clearly can see that it has a lot of advantages, which I've explained previously. So for the essence of setting the plot size here is because if I don't set the plot size, I will be getting most of my plots covering half a page. Okay, because for some reason, that's what happens. So I use this function to actually get a bigger view. All right, so now, so suppose one day you are doing a particular task, and then you Googled how to do, let's say you wanted to do combined plots, or you wanted to do some regression analysis or something, and you Googled, and after Googling, you realized that there was a blog, someone had created a blog, where the first thing you saw was they've written library of this, library of ggplot, library of that, before they went into their codes. What you need to do first, before you even make use of any of their codes, is that you have to install all those packages. Anytime you see library around something, that thing inside is a package, okay? And then we've learned how to install packages. I told you that some versions of R might not permit you to install some specific packages. It doesn't matter whether you are using a more advanced version or you are using a lower version, it doesn't matter. Some packages will work perfectly in low versions of R, but might not work work in the high versions. Okay, so anytime you see library of something, when you go online, you are looking for some information, the first thing is to install. And to install, if it doesn't work, if you watch the second YouTube video, we learned how to install the packages directly from GitHub, because we said that every package can actually be installed and it's actually put on GitHub, so you can install directly from GitHub, and I explain how you go about it. So if you don't know that, please don't forget to watch the second video. All right, so now let's import the data. So now to import the data, we will run this, and don't forget what the head of this is doing. Now I've imported the data, and then to import the data, I just had to specify the data name. The data I'm using is called university_data. Okay, so I just specified the data name, and it would import straight from the repository or from the folder called data analysis_resource folder. Okay, now don't forget that the head is used to view the first. So for instance, if I specify n equals, let's say 6, okay, then it will view the first 6 rows, okay, of the data. I can actually use, instead of head, I can also use tail. So if I write tail, it will give me the last 6 in this case. If I don't specify any n, by default, it will return the last six, as you can see. So this is for the tail, and this is for the head, okay? And then you can specify the n, how many rows you want to see, but usually just using the head is fine. Instead of the head, you can also use the extraction. I remember I told you that we can use the square bracket for extraction, okay? And then the square bracket, once you bring a square bracket like this with a comma, the first part here is representing the rows, and this is representing the columns. So if I want to see the first 10 rows, I can equally put 1 to 10 like this and run. Okay, so that one will also give me the first 10 rows. So there are so many things to do the same task in R. And that's the beauty about programming languages in general. You can, there are so many ways to arrive at the same thing, okay? Fine. So after importing the data, maybe you would want to check whether they are missing data or whether there are any missing values in the data. So I'm using this function. So the is.na is of the data. So don't forget, the original data was university_data, but I have saved it in an object called data_uni. Okay, and the essence is that this is the name that I want to be using for the subsequent part of the code. Okay, so now currently the name of our imported data is now called data_uni. And then I want to know whether there's any missing value. So all I needed to do was to use is.na means that, is there any NA? NA are missing values or not applicable. So suppose you import an Excel data, and then maybe some specific columns were having missing values. Automatically, I will replace those missing values by NA, okay? And NA, when you see NA in after importing your data, it meant that there were missing values in your data, okay? To know there are missing values, you can run this function, and then it tells false. Once it tells false, it means there are no missing value. Suppose if it says true, then it means there are missing values. And please, you realize that anytime I bring some hashtag here and write something there, those are not part of the course. The hashtag is just there to comment my course. And it's a very good practice that you need to develop once you are writing your course. Or else, if you just use this without putting any comment and some future time, you come back and you ask yourself, what were you trying to achieve with this particular line of code? But if you had added the comment would tell you that, oh, you were trying to check for missing values. So don't forget that in the process of programming or doing data analysis, it's always advisable that with your code, you comment them. And to comment, just bring an hashtag and put whatever you want to write. The hashtag can be put on top of the code, behind the code, in front, but not in front. The very moment you put in front, it means you've now commented or you've now considered it as a comment, okay? But it can be put behind it, on top of it, or below it, it doesn't matter. Now, I wanted to check the dimension of the data. So using DIM around the data, okay, actually tells me that the data has 2,331 rows and 7 columns. So at the moment, the 7 columns means that we have only 7 variables that we are going to work with. But don't forget, we are going to add additional variables, okay? So originally, the data had only 7 columns. 7 columns means 7 rows. Seven columns means seven variables. Okay, sorry for that. And then writing names around the data tells you the variables. Okay, so that is just to extract the names of the variables. And be careful. You realize that here, after typing the name, running the names, this is how, so when you copy, let's say, let's copy mathematics. When I'm copying, ignore the quotation signs, okay? Now, there's a variable called high-level mathematics. Have you seen their full stop or dots in between high-level? It was because originally, when we were entering the data in the Excel, which was converted to CSV, we spaced it like this. So arrow doesn't work with spaces like that. So automatically, it will just fill it like this with a dot. And that's why sometimes I will put an underscore here, especially when I'm labeling some of the variables, if you remember, so that it's like I'm telling it how I want it to be seen, instead of letting R to decide to put a full stop in between. Okay, so, and then if there are full stop here after the because of the blank space in the original data, if you import and R is now saying that it only sees high level mathematics variable with these dots, and you remove the dots, you'll be getting errors. So you have to be using it as such. So at some point in your coding, you should always be calling back names of data to be sure of the exact name that R actually assigned it. Okay, so don't forget that. All right, so let's continue. All right, so and now the first task is to assign the names to the variable called residence. And originally residence was entered. So if you want to see how residence was looking, let me open this cell. So originally, if you run resident, okay, so meaning that I call the data and I bring a dollar sign a resident. Don't forget, I told you can use the attach function. Okay, so at the moment, let's look at something. If I run this, it tells me all the variables, all the data for residents, okay? And it's a couple of ones and twos and fours and threes, okay? At the moment, R sees this as numerical. It doesn't see it as categorical, but you know that it's supposed to be categorical, okay? Now, if I remove this data and type residents, you see I've gotten an error because R is saying that it doesn't recognize anything called resident. But the very moment I use attach of the data unit, okay? And I copy this one and bring it down here, okay? So now if I run, it recognizes it because after attaching the data, R is automatically able to recognize all the variables. By last week with the second YouTube video, I explained the disadvantages of the attach. It is useful if you are only working with one data. That is fine, no problem with that. But the very moment you are working with more than two data sets and some of the variable names are similar and you attach, it will be very difficult for you to know exactly at what point which of the data or which of the variables R is using, whether it's using that variable from data one or data two. So that's why the attach can be sometimes very, very strange to do. So it's always advisable that you use the dollar sign to prevent attaching. If you want to detach or prevent that, you just write detach around the data. Now, if I run this, you realize that it doesn't recognize residents anymore, okay? Yes, so always be using the dollar sign. So now if you use the dollar sign and specify the name of the variable, you wouldn't have a problem. All right, so now let's continue. So because resident is coded as 1, 2, 3, and 4, okay? And you want to know the levels. Now see something, if I copy this, let me open this, create a cell up here, insert a cell up. And then if I should look type levels of this, you realize that I got null. The null is because numerical variables do not have categories. But the very moment I choose any variable that R has seen as categorical, for instance, the program measure, if I run this, it will tell me all the categories, okay? And then, but since the variable residence was coded as 1, 2, if you use it as such here and you run, you get error. You get a null. But in order for R to know that it's a factor, you can just say as.factor around the variable means that R should treat it as a factor. In that case, if I put as dot factor around this, as dot factor around this, okay, then you get the actual levels. So don't confuse yourself with s dot factor. S dot factor and as dot factor, as dot factor. So s dot factor is to ask, is the variable a categorical variable or a factor? So for instance, if I put s dot factor around program measure, see what happens. S dot factor. So let me bring data under uni underscore uni the dollar. Okay. So it says true. So the s dot factor is to ask R that is the variable a factor or a categorical variable. Okay. But the very moment I make it as dot factor means that treat it as a factor, impose that variable and make it a factor. Okay. And that's why we put as dot factor around the residence variable just for R to treat it as a factor. And in that case, we're able to know the exact categories. All right. Now to specify the names of the categories, we said we use the function called factor, and then you put the variable name, and don't forget the same variable you want to treat or convert to or assign the codes. That's the same variable we've put here, and the same variable we've actually also put here. Then we specify the level. So the levels is what we obtain from this part. So the levels are 1, 2, 3. And we said that 1 means south, 2 means north, 3 means east, and 4 means west. So this is how simple you can assign codes and names to your categories. All right. So now when you run, when you look at the first 8 rows, don't forget I'm looking at the first 8 rows. If I wanted to look at the second and third column, I can put a concatenate sign here, a C, put 1 and 3. This is just to extract the first and third column, the first and the third column as well. So you realize that this was the first and this was the third column. All right. Now I'm just interested in all, so I won't put anything there. Fine. So at the moment you can see that now, let me run this. Okay. So if I now run this, you can now see that now resident has now been converted. The categories has now been assigned the names. Okay. Then the next thing is to create a new variable called total point. And we said total point is just adding enrollment point. Enrollment point is this, and adding the mathematics point. So this is how simple you can just create additional numerical variables. You see, I just brought the data name, and then the enrollment is just mean that I've called the enrollment variable and I'm adding enrollment point to mathematics point. And the addition, I'm using the normal plus sign. Okay, the normal plus sign. And then now don't forget that the new variable is total point. And see, you just have to bring the data with the dollar and put any name you want to give. And I want to call the new variable data point. So you realize that I have used that same name here. And then I'm considering the sum of this. Now, if I run this one, you realize that the total point, the new variable has been created. And then it is the sum of the enrollment point and the mathematics point. And it will do it component element wise. So it's doing it this plus the zero, this plus 77, and it will do for each of the rows as well, okay? And then the next one was, we wanted to convert the mathematics point into low class if the mathematics point is less than 40, median class if the mathematics point is between, or is actually from. So don't confuse between 40 and 70 with from 70, 40 and to 70. If I said between 40 and 70, it meant that 40 and 70 are not inclusive. But since I'm saying from 40 to 70, meaning that both are inclusive, okay? And then the next one is high class if the mathematics point is greater than 70. And remember that we use something called the cat function to do that, okay? And here you should be careful with the threshold. So let me just create, open a cell here. So if you remember, so to create that, I will just copy and paste this. So now I'm calling the new variable, the new categorical variable that I want to create as mathematics grade. And then I will just use the assign sign. I told you here, you can use either equal to or the assign. Okay, and both will work. So you can stick to anyone you want. But we use this because it looks fancy. All right, then before then, it will be advisable to specify your thresholds. Now with your thresholds, you can give any name to it. With your threshold, okay, be very careful so that you do it exactly as the categories assume. So the first category was less than 40. So I'll put 40 here. And then 40 to 70. So I'll put 70. When I'm done, I'll do some editing for you to see. And the next one is when it's greater than 70. So now you've put 40, 70. So don't forget that you always have to start from the minimum value. Okay. So always it's advisable to know what is the minimum value for the math, the data you actually want to categorize. So if I just put mean around a variable called mathematics points. So let me copy this one. Okay, so let me comment this. So if I run this one, it means that the minimum mathematics point is 0. And what is the maximum? The maximum is actually 100, okay? So since we know the minimum and the maximum, so to specify the thresholds, so I bring the concatenate sign, because I told you if you are creating any vector or strings or array, one-dimensional array of numbers, you use the concatenate and separated by commas. So you specify the minimum first. So I initially wrote the 40, the 70, okay? So you have to specify the minimum, which is 0. So here, the first is from 0 to 40. And the second is 0 to 70, 40 to 70. And then we can now put the maximum here, okay? But here, be careful. Another thing you have to be careful, especially if you want to get exactly how we define. We said that the mathematics point, when it is 40 or less means that 40 is not part of the low class. The medium class actually starts from 40 to 70, okay? And don't forget, in creating point intervals, when you specify an interval, let's say 0, 0, and then 0 to 40, for instance. Let me use markdown, okay? So if I run this one, this means that 0 and 40 are inclusive, okay, in the range. If I now make here open, this means that 0 is inclusive, but 40 is not inclusive. But look at this one. Clearly, 40 is not what? Inclusive. So it meant for the first category, I need this interval, okay? But the second category, it is actually from 40, meaning that 40 is inclusive, to 70, meaning that 70 is inclusive, okay? So it's supposed to be this. But here, now let's see something. So now we are specifying the new variable. So for the mathematics grade, we are using the cat function, and we are saying that we want to convert the numerical variable, which is mathematics point. So I'll just copy it. It's good to be copying and pasting. Okay. And then I have to specify breaks. So here, since it is less than 40, I am fine with considering 0 to 40. But for the second category, and don't forget, after specifying the breaks, we put something called right. Whether it's true or false, I'm putting false. And why am I putting false? I'm trying to say that it shouldn't consider the endpoint. The intervals, it should assume that the extreme end is not part. So for instance, if you look at the 0 to 40, I'm saying that it shouldn't consider the 40. If I had made the right to be true, it meant it will not consider the 0 to be part, but it will consider the 40. So don't forget that. So I'm considering the right to be false means that the upper bound of the interval should not be included. However, here it means that for 0 to 40, 40 will not be included. We've satisfied the first category, which is less than 40, we are fine. Now from 40 to 70, now automatically when the right is false, it will still consider the lower one, which is 40. But since the right is false, it won't consider the upper, which is 70. So instead of writing 70 here, I would rather write 71 or 70 point something. If I write 71, it means that automatically it will not consider 70, but it can consider anything less than 70. Where this 70 will fall apart, okay? So here, so be careful when you are doing the thresholds. And then the maximum, don't forget that if the right is false, okay, and you consider this one is contributing from 71 to 100, and it's ignoring the 100. But don't forget, 100 is also, because here we are saying that is when it's greater than 70, and the highest value is up to 100. So in that case, the best I will do is I'll write 101, okay? If I write 101, it means that the right equals false will not consider 101, but it will consider something less than that, which is 100. So this is how smart you should be when you are assigning the category. So I wouldn't waste much time anymore. So now if we run this and call the data. Let me, so now if you view the data, let's use the head around this. Head around this. Now we have, you can see that. So you can see that now it has done the categorization in this form, but this is not how, this is how you want, but you want to give the name. So you have to specify the levels, that levels equals, so the first category is equal to what? So that is what, when you come here, you see, so the first category is low class, the next one is medium, and then last one is high class, okay? So this is how simple you can. So don't forget, if you don't specify the names of the categories, you'll be seeing these things, and this is not what you want to see. You want to see low class, medium class, high class. So you have to put labels inside here and specify, bring a C, and specify the first one is low class. You just write low class. Okay, and don't forget that once you bring these quotation marks, this quotation sign, whatever variable, you can space it anyhow you want, okay? So, because it's a string, and always strings has to be in a quotation, and then medium, then you just specify and so on, okay? So I'll just ignore this. So that is what this is actually achieving. So now we've done that, okay? Now the next thing was to save our data. So now this is our new data. Originally it had only 7 columns, but now you can see that it has 9 columns. So meaning that originally it was 9 variables. Now we've been able to, it was 7 variables. We've been able to add a new variable, and even the resident, we've assigned the categories, the names to the categories. And then we've considered another variable called total point, which is the sum of the math point and a Roman point. And we also have another variable called math grade, which is if your math point is less than 40% is low class. If your math point is from 40 to 70 is, so you look at something. So for low class, 0, it was 0, so low class. 77 was greater than 70, so it was high class. So you see 55, we said medium class is actually something from 40 to what? 40 to 70, okay? So you can clearly see that we have it. And now we want to save this new data so that in future time, you wouldn't have to go through the same, go through all the stress you've gone through now. So you use write.csv here if you want to save your data as a CSV. So write.csv, then you specify the data, and now any name you want to give to, you put it here. I want to label the new data that is going into the folder. I want to label it as university_data_updated. Then you add .csv. If you run this one, it automatically saves it into your repository, okay? So you can now go back to your folder and then you see the data there, okay? And then I told you, you cannot create mode directly, okay? Because if I want to find mode of any variable, so for instance, if I want to find mode, for median, if you use the normal mean function, the normal median function, it works. But if you use mode around, let's say a variable _uni, and you use a variable, let's say, I want to find the mode of enrollment point, and I run this one, okay? It rather tells me numeric. If I had put mean here, it will give me the exact mean. If I had put median, it will give me the exact median. But the normal, the mode here doesn't return the mode you want. It rather tells you the type of variable your variable is. So now if I put mode, if I check the mode of the math grade, which is now categorical, you see the math grade, why did he say is, because it's a factor now, so what happened? Okay, so if I check the mode, why is it saying, okay, let me see if I check the class instead. Okay, so sometimes the mode is actually not useful. If you want to check the type of variable, use the class. So if you use class, it's now telling me the variable grade is a factor. When I use the mode, it was telling me it's numeric, which doesn't make sense. Okay, so keep that in mind. Now to find the actual mode, I've created this function for you. So when you run this function and now you run get mode around the variable, let's say enrollment point. Okay, if I put this one here, now it's telling me that the mode is 458, meaning that 458 appeared more frequently than the other variables. If you want to confirm that, you can write table of this variable, and it will tell you all the unique variables and how many times they appeared. So it will tell you 300 appeared 2 times. Let's see the variable which appeared more frequently. It said 458. What is 458? 458. 458 appeared 57 times, and it's greater than any other thing. I mean, the next highest is 55, okay? So it means that our mode function is really working, okay? So there's a fine, you don't need to create your own mode function anymore. You can just use this for anything you want to do. All right, so now the next thing was to create the summary statistics function. And we said that the summary statistics function should first of all determine the type of variable. If it is numerical, it should compute the mean, median, mode, standard deviation, skewness, ketosis, 95% quantiles, record them to two decimal places, and also plot histogram plots, and then even color it blue, okay? And then when it's categorical, it should rather compute the percentages and return it as a data frame, where the data frame will see the percentages and the categories it is representing. And then it should also plot the pie chart with different colors. But here, be careful, because some of the variables could be more than, some variables could be more than, let's say, 10 categories. In that case, you wouldn't want to specify your own colors. You can actually use a package that you can put n to be equal to 5, and then it will generate 5 colors for you. You can put n to be equal to 10, and it will generate 10 colors for you. But most of these packages can do up to, I think some can do up to 12 or 13, okay, different colors. So here you see something I did. All right, so you've already seen most of these, the complex summary statistics function. And please, you can use this function for any data you want, okay? Any data. So now we remember, I won't go through the details because we already know this function. I'll only tell you the new addition. So don't forget, we specified the name of the function and the name of the variable. So we said name around the data, we'll extract all the names of the data, and then indexing it with the variable index here will just extract that particular variable, which we've already gone through this. So I wouldn't go much into it. Now we are saying that if the variable is categorical, and don't forget to bring your open bracket. So it means that if it's categorical, it is doing up to this point, up to here. So if it is categorical, or what I've highlighted, if it is categorical, it should first of all compute the mean, which is mean of the variable, the median of the variable, the mode. I use the get mode. So it means that you can create your own function and use it within a new function, and it will also work, okay? So the get mode function is here for the mode. For the standard deviation, SD around the variable, standard error is the standard deviation divided by square root of the sample size. And I told you that the sample size is just the length of each of the variable, okay? And then the skewness we use a package called movement, because there wasn't inbuilt function for skewness and ketosis. We needed to use a package. And that package, after loading the package, you can now specify skewness and it will do it for you, which we've already gone through that. For the quantiles too, if you watch the previous video, I explained what quantiles are. And then I explained that we are interested in just the 95th quantile, which will extract two variables. And the two variables will be, the first variable will tell you that approximately 2.5% of the data is less than that value, and approximately 97.5% is less than the upper one, okay? And then this is the part where I was plotting the histogram. And so I just wrote histogram of the variable, and then it should paste the name of the variable. I specify the color to be blue. And don't forget that if you don't put main and then bring a quotation without anything there, it would use the default name of the variable. You can put anything here. Suppose you want it to paste the name of the variable. I could have still used the paste here, this paste here, and put it here, and it will work. But I don't want to label it. So you can always change it to suit what you want. So at the end of the day, after computing this, it should return the name of the variable. So meaning that we've made it in such a way that even if you don't know the names of your variables and you use a new data set and you just specify the index, maybe you want to know the summary statistics of the first column, it will tell you the name of the first column, the median, that is if it is numerical, the mean, the median, and everything, and then it will return everything, and here is the histogram, and so it will do this. But if it is categorical, so here is where I want you to take a close look, because I've added a little new things here. The previous one, it was just a few addition I added for the numerical when it's numeric. If it is categorical, so we use is it a factor to indicate whether it's a categorical, okay? And if that is true, now what we are saying is that it should first of all compute the percentages, okay? And after computing the percentages using, so don't forget the table of the variable divided by the number of rows, okay, would convert it to proportions. And now we are multiplying by 100%, okay? And that would now convert it to percentage. And we are saying that we are rounding it to the nearest one decimal place. And that's why I brought round and I put one here. So this one means that it should round those percentages by one decimal place. And then it should paste this percentage sign to it. We've already gone through this in the previous two videos, okay? And now here, this is where I wanted you to keep in mind. So now, okay, the output, now we are saving the names of the categories and their corresponding percentages as a data frame, which you've seen here. So this is the new addition from here. So don't forget that when it's a factor, it's actually from here to this side is when it's a categorical variable. Now here, what we are saying here is that now, so first of all, the percentage values, now I'm extracting only the percentage values without the percentage sign because I want to paste it on the pie chart. And here too, what I want to paste on the pie chart is that it should tell me the name of the name of the category, okay? And then it should also add so here it's telling the name of the category and also the percentage value, and it should add a percentage sign to it. And that's basically what this three lines is trying to achieve, okay? Or these three lines are trying to achieve. And here I told you that since some variables might have more than 10 levels, I wouldn't want to specify manually red color, green color, blue color, and yellow color. You might even be short of the names of the colors if suppose the categories are more. So what I used here is that if the levels of the variable is less than 3, okay? If it is less than 3, I could have just used if it is equal to 2. So I could have just used equal to 2. Don't forget, double equal to really means equality. The single equal to is not equality, it's assignment. Now, I could use this, or I could just, because there's no way the categorical variable will have only one level. There's no way. So I could have just said if it is 2, but I could also just say if it is less than 3. Less than 3 means 2 or less, okay? So that's fine, just to generalize. So if it is less than 3, it should mean that definitely it's going to be 2 categories, okay? Okay, or let me just say if it is 2. If it is 2 means double equal to, that's fine, and it will still work. Now, if it is 2, it should give red to the first category and blue to the next one. And then this is a pie chart. So it's plotting the percentage values, and then it is giving the labels or the names of the categories with the percentages based on it, which I've defined it here already. And then, yeah, so, and then it should specify the colors as well, okay? Else, if the number of variables is something greater than 3, now for the colors, I'm using a certain package called R colors or something. When you go when I was loading the packages, so there was a color called, was it red color, blue or something? So that was the name of the package. Okay, let me go up shortly. So the package for is also to produce a lot of colors, different colors. Yes, this one, R color brew or whatever. So this helps us to get customized and a lot of colors, okay? But you can always specify your own color, red, yellow, green, magenta, whatever you want. So let me calm down, Fine. So here I'm saying that if the categories, okay, if it is greater than 3, actually greater or equal to 3, if it is 3 or more, then I'm using the package name. I mean, the package function that extracts a lot of colors. But how many colors should it extract? So I'm equating the n to the length of the proportion, the percentages. So suppose the percentages are three different percentages. It meant there were three different categories. So then it means that it should choose three colors for me. If the colors, if they are 12, then the length of the percentage values will be 12 different values. And this length of that will choose 12 different colors for me. So basically that's what I have tried to achieve here. So you can also go through at your own pace and you should be fine. But that's the ideology. So that now it will automatically, but don't forget that the colors cannot be more, it can only do colors. I think that this function can only do colors up to, is it 12 or 13? Okay, so situations where you have more than 12 variables, you can also add extra condition. Okay, and so don't forget that. Okay, so let's continue. All right, so for the for loop here, don't forget, I've not talked anything about for loop for now, but this one is just to tell you which of the variables and the index or the position. So it meant the program, the first variable, which was program, major program is the first variable, and then the math grade is the ninth, okay? So now don't forget that the summary statistics we've created. So this is now what I wanted you to keep in mind. So let me just open a new thing here. So now, if you now use the function I have created, so now let me run this. So this is the function. So what this function is doing, I've already explained that it asks whether it's numerical, and if it's numerical, it computes all those summary statistics with histogram. If it's categorical, it computes the percentages and everything, and also add pie charts as well. Now, suppose your data was called data_uni. All you need to do is to put, if I want to see the summary statistics for the third variable, I just put 3 here. I don't know, suppose I don't even know the variable, let me run. It tells me that the variable name is type, and then it gives me the percentages, and here's it. It gives us the pie chart. So that's how beautiful we can actually create our own functions to do a lot of things for us. So now it means that I don't have to now create pie charts again. All I need to do is that I just have to use my summary statistics function. If that variable, if you know this exact variable you want to look at, its pie chart, you can just put the variable here. So suppose I want to look at math grade is 9. I just put 9 here and just run. It's a function brewer pal cannot, meaning that we didn't run, I didn't load this packages. Okay, let me. Okay. Oh, previously I didn't load the packages. Okay, so I'm loading now the packages. Okay, so then I will run the summary statistics function again. All right, fine. So now, so suppose I put 9 here. Okay, so now it tells me that the variable is math grade. It gives me the exact percentages. The math grade was low, we had categories low class, medium class, high class. It tells you exactly the percentages, even recorded in one decimal place for you. And then it gives you the pie chart. How beautiful can it be? Okay, so that's the beauty about this. Suppose I put 1 here, see what happens. If I put 1 here, now the first variable was major program. You see, I don't even need to know the name of the variable. I just have to put the index number and it will tell me the name of the variable. It gives me all the categories, the percentages, and here is the, you can clearly see how beautiful the pie chart is looking. So this was the essence of that package for the difference and the different colors. So since there were 11 different categories, it has chosen 11 different colors for me because of how we defined it, okay? But this is where I said, if it is more than 13, then you would want to add extra colors to the previous 11 or 12 it could contain, and you should be fine, all right? Okay, so that is that for the summary statistics function we've created. So it meant if you put, let's say 3 here, it gives this. If you put 4, it tells us a certain variable, and the name of the variable is enrollment point. Suppose we didn't even know the variable name. It tells us that the variable is enrollment point, and the mean is this. Suppose I'm just interested in extracting the mean. You can just use the function and bring a dollar sign and just write mean. This will just return just the mean. And then it gives you the pie chart anyway. It gives you the histogram anyway. If you don't bring any dollar sign, it will give you everything. The mean, the median, the mode, the standard deviation, the standard error ketosis, the quantiles. And when you come down, you have your histogram plot. So this is a function that has never been created in R. So it's great that we have created this for the first time, and we can actually write a package for this so that you can consider any data, just specify the name of the data and put any column you want to look at the summary. If you want to look for all of them, just specify when for the first column, put index to be one, second two, and you are good to go. It gives you that everything as well. Okay, so basically here I'll just specify when it's two, and then I'll specify when it's three, and so on. So I'll just go down straight to the history. Yeah. So the next task was to look at how we can get customized plots using ggplot. Okay, because these plots I have done using the base plot in R. Okay, so meaning that to do this pie chart and the histogram, I didn't need a package for that, but I only needed a package to choose different colors if we have more variables and I don't want to manually specify red, green, yellow, and so on and so forth. Okay, then it will do that automatically for me. All right, so now for the histogram plot, I won't waste time, I'll just explain what each is doing. You get the codes. I would actually put the R script on Piazza. So if you are not on Piazza, it will be difficult for you to get access, but you can always contact me for it. And then, So keep in mind that I would also give you, I'll save this this script as R script. I told you if I go to file and I go to download as, okay, I can download as R. So if I download as R here, it will download as the normal script you were doing in the R Studio. Exactly the normal script you are doing in the R Studio, just that you won't see the graphs and you won't see the results. And I'll also download it as HTML file. When I download it as HTML file, you will see all the codes as well as the graphs, everything. You will see everything, just that you only need your browser to open it. So you just open with any of your browsers, whether Mozilla, whether Chrome, Google Chrome, or whatever, or Explorer, and then it will open it, and then you see the codes, the graphs, and everything. And when you want to copy the graphs into your folder, all you need to do is that in the HTML file, just right click on the graph and click save as, okay? And then go and specify the folder. So this is the folder. The folder was this is the data analysis folder. You remember the data that we saved from R Studio? Yeah, here is it. It came directly into our repository, okay? Then I have to just give the name and then we are good to go. Then I click save, okay? So that's how easy. So it means that for your in future studies, if you are doing a PhD or you are doing your master's and you'll be meeting your supervisors frequently, I think if you want to do your data analysis, even if it could be in your profession, maybe you are a data scientist. I believe that the R Studio has a lot to offer than using the Jupyter Notebook has a lot to offer than using the R Studio, as you can clearly see, okay? Because you can actually use this for presentation. You don't even need to create PowerPoint or something. You can actually use this to do your presentation. If you save it as an HTML file, you can just be using the HTML file and then you'll be able to show how you generated everything and at the same time. Okay, so don't forget that very soon we'll be switching from R Studio to Jupyter Notebook. But I wanted you to get a feel of the R Studio first, and then I wanted to convince you why the Jupyter Notebook was the best. And I told you that so for now, if I should come here, I also told you, if I come here and I click new, it tells you that at the moment I can run three different programming languages at the same time, Julia, Python, R at the same time. Okay, so Jupyter Notebook is a very powerful IDE. Okay, so now let's go straight. So now we wanted to produce some plot with a ggplot. So now, first of all, look at this plot. So always, if I give you this function, all you need to do is that look at the plot, okay? And then try and see that, first of all, I wanted it's basically trying to plot proportions, right, or percentages, but I'm also doing it across other categories, okay? So now I want to look at the proportion for students in terms of type of program, whether those in program A or K. And at the same time, I want to distinguish between their languages. So always, which plot you should use or which plot you should do is always dependent on what you want, or it could be dependent on what your client wants. Suppose you're a data scientist and your client was interested in seeing the proportion of students under each program and also across the different types of languages used, okay? So always, you don't just produce any plot anyhow. Produce a plot with based on what you really want, okay? Fine, so here, the x-axis, I want it to be type, and I want to group with respect to languages. So that's why, so when the group here, when I put languages, then it splits the languages. Okay, so keep in mind that in the ggplot, once you specify the data, you don't have to be using dollar signs anymore. Okay, once you that is in the ggplot function. Once you specify the data, it will automatically recognize all the variables. So in that case, you don't need to be bringing the data name again with the dollar sign inside. All you need to just do is the variable names. So suppose you've forgotten all the variable names, just type names around the data underscore uni. Okay, so it meant that type. So I just copy type. And when I'm copying, I don't copy the quotation signs. It's not necessary, okay? Because that's not a variable. So don't copy this one. So don't copy this and post and paste it here. With the quotation, it will not recognize. So you have to take away these single quotations from it. So use the actual name, and then I'm grouping it per language, okay? And what this part is doing is that it's going to do a bar plot, and then it's going to consider the proportions, okay? And then, so you don't have to change anything. You don't have to change anything here. You don't have to change anything where I've highlighted. All you need to change is the type of variable, the category you're interested in. And if you want to split across languages, you put it under the group. And then when you plot, and suppose the X axis. So suppose if I don't label X, see what happens. Now it does the plot, but it wrote type. Maybe I want to call it type of scholarship. The variable name was actually type of scholarship. So I can now manually label the X axis using plus X label and write type of program. So in that case, if I run, it will now give me the actual name I want. Okay, so always you can label the X axis and the Y axis anyhow you want. And then because it was a customized plot I was doing, I added something called caption. This caption, I can take it off. Okay, but suppose in some future, in your PhDs, or let's say in your master's or maybe undergrad studies, suppose you did a plot and you wanted to tell them the source, and you wanted to tell them that the plot is actually generated by you, okay? So the caption here, so you realize that I've written caption and I've written Clement School on data analysis. So what you realize is that if I add that caption, okay, it gives something down here, which is more like trying to give a source. So it meant that if someone copies this data on the internet, the person will see that it is a plot actually produced from or produced by Clement School on data analysis. So this is how you can actually add references or sources to your plot if you are using ggplot. If I take this off, so let me take the caption out, okay? So if I take away the caption, this is what happens. You don't see anything anymore there. Okay, so the caption is just to give a source. Okay, so that in some future time, if someone is picking this from the internet, the person will know where it's actually coming from. Okay, so the same thing I did here. I just have to copy this one and come and paste and change the first one. Now I'm interested in residents. So now I'm interested in knowing across the residents the proportion for each of the grades in terms of the maths, the low class, the medium class. So what this is saying is that it's trying to tell us that approximately, like, well, let's say 44.8% of students from the South, okay, actually are coming from the low class, okay? So basically, I mean, so that's what I'm saying, that if we want to do across any category, put the name of the category here. And here too, if you want to now distinguish across different categories, so I can just copy this one, paste it here, and now copy the resident and put it as groups, meaning that it will distinguish between the rest and the residents instead. So always what you want is what you specify, and it does this exactly. So all I did was I copied the codes here and just change the variable names. So that's all you'll be doing. So for any new data, it's the same code. Just specify the name of the data you are using, and then just specify the first categorical variable you want to consider on the x-axis, And if you want to distinguish across some other category, just put it here and don't bring the dollar sign once you are within the context of what? The ggplot. You don't, within the ggplot environment, you don't need to bring the dollar sign of the variable anymore, okay? So that's basically that. And then the next one, so this is also, so what I did was here too, I did another bar plot, okay? But here I wanted to show you that you can also combine more than two plots at the same time for ggplot. So in that case, what you do is that you realize that when I was doing this, I didn't add any object name. I could have just write, let's say p equals this. And then if I write p equals this and I run, you don't see anything, right? Because it has saved in the object. So all you need to do is to call back p. So if I type p here and I now run everything, you realize that it will return everything for you, okay? So there are instances you can just save this as an object. You don't save it as an object if you're not interested in trying to plot more than one thing at the same time, okay? So here, I'm not putting any object name here. But the very moment I want to combine two plots, see, I wanted to combine this plot and also this plot on the same page. So in that case, I have to give an object name to the whole of this function as G1. You can use any name and also give another name to this one called G2 and use this line of code. So this line of code, what it does is that it tells you you are trying to combine. So suppose there were four plots. You can continue on comma G3, comma G4. Suppose you have also done G3 and G4, okay? And then you can specify the number of rows and also the number of columns. So at the moment, we have only two plots. Now the two plots, if I don't specify any column, it automatically consider the default as one, okay? So now I have specified the column as one, so it will also do as the previous one. If I consider the column to be two, but the number of rows to be one, see what we get. Usually, you wouldn't want to put, you wouldn't want to consider only one row, okay? Because you see the graph looks messy. So it is always advisable that if you are plotting more graphs, always you would want to consider more rows than columns, okay? And in that case, it's like you get something that is looking better, okay? And then, the next one was just to do also another bar plot. But in this case, you realize that the other ones were vertical, but this one is slanting, okay? And here, there is something I did. If I remove divided by 1,000, see what happens. If I remove this one, okay? Now here too, I'm specifying measure program, the measure of the program at the total point. And here, there's something called flip, coordinate flip. So that is what is flipping or converting this one into something horizontal, okay? So you just have to, but I think this is useful if you have so many categories. If you have so many categories, you wouldn't want to use these ones, okay? But if you have so many categories, it's good to use the flip one, which like this, because in that case, it can pick so many variables and you still get a nice plot, okay? So don't forget that. And I also explain plus team underscore between. If you remove the team underscore between and you run, okay, you realize that now there are gray lines inside. If the gray lines is nice for you, that is fine. Okay, that is fine. But I didn't want the gray lines. It depends on you, okay? So the plus between helps you. And don't forget that, if I bring the plus down here, I'm going to get an error. Always make sure the plus is starting, or you can just put the other one on the last line. Or if suppose here was very long and it has covered everything here, you can still put the plus and just bring this down. Or you can put everything on the same line and you are good to go, okay? So don't forget that. Fine. So that was that for this one. But now notice something. With this, sometimes it has extra zeros. So technically the total point, let's look at the nature of the variables for total point. So if I specify data uni and I call total point, okay? Total point. So here, what I was trying to achieve was that I was trying to look at the distribution of the total point across all the major, the program measures, okay? So that's basically what I was trying to achieve. So always you can tell what you want to achieve and do it as such, okay? And then you just have to copy this, use this code and edit to suit whatever you want to do, all right? And then if you want to do something different and something different and you don't even know, just Google how to, you can even Google ggplot graphs in R. And I think I added a link here, which can be useful to you. So you see this link, it gives you 50 different plots in ggplot. Some of the plots are very advanced. And then you can just copy the codes on this website and also try and see how you can generate some of the because it's just like, suppose I have this function or these codes on that website. You just copy and edit it to suit what you are doing. Always you have to know that the first one here is the name of the data, and then you specify the variables as such. Okay, so if you want 50 different plots in ggplot, I have added a link which will be in the HTML file. This link, if I download it as R, you will not be able to see the link. But I'll also add, I'll add the R script for you to use for your R studio. But I'll also save this one as an HTML file for you to be able to download and access everything as you are seeing. Okay, so don't worry about that. All right, so let me just speed up quickly and end. So yeah, so here, all I wanted you to notice that you realize that I took, if now if you look at, let's say the maximum of the total point, even the maximum value is just 590. Okay, so this 590, but come and look at these values. It has added extra zeros. So if you can see, it has added, so the zeros are a couple of what? Couple of hundred, but it has added extra three zeros. Okay, so that's something, it's a scaling problem. So all I need to do is that for the total point, I just specify the total point. So always use the actual variable, don't edit it, run it. And if you check the maximum, and the maximum is having only three digits, and you came and you realize that it's having now extra three zeros. If it was extra two zeros, you rather come here and divide by 100. Now it's extra three zeros, so I'm dividing by three zeros, okay? So if I run this one, now if you come down here, you can clearly see that you have 0, 50, so here is around 500 and something. So now you have it the way you want. So always don't forget about this scaling. It's just a scaling problem, okay? So always ignore this one, run and see how many zeros have been added to your date, to the x-axis. Since it is three extra zeros, if you want to know how many zeros has been added, probably it will be advisable to check the maximum or the minimum. Maybe the maximum will do the maximum, and the maximum will tell you how many digits the maximum had. So if the maximum had three digits, and now you are seeing three zeros, just divide by the extra three zeros, and then you run, and you'll be fine. So now everything has been scaled perfectly. All right, so now to do box plot. So here I'm trying to compare the distribution of the enrollment points, and I'm comparing it between across the language of program, okay, the distribution. But at the same time, I'm also comparing between the type of program, okay? So here is language of program that I'm comparing the distribution, but I'm also trying to do it across the program type. So at the end of the day, you are getting two different, because I'm doing it across the program type, that's why I'm getting two different. If I had not specified, fill equals type, suppose now, let me take fill equals type here. If I take this out, you now see that I now have the pie chart that is for trying to look at the box plot, trying to compare the distribution between the distribution of enrollment points between just the English and then the Hungarian students, okay? Hungarian speaking students. But now I really wanted to do something extra. So I wanted to also distinguish between the type of program. So I added fill equals. So you can always edit this, edit it with other variables, run it and see the output. Okay, so there are a lot of try and error you should be doing, and also trying to be curious, changing variables and seeing the kind of output you are getting, so that when you get a new data set, you know exactly what you are doing. So now specify fill equals type. So in this case, if I run, then I'm getting this nice thing. You realize I didn't take the gray line. If I wanted to take the gray line, I could have added plus team underscore BW with this. If I run this one, it has taken the gray lines. If we're interested in the gray line background, fair enough. There are instances I love it. In this case, I want to see the gray lines. I just love it when I'm doing box plot and the gray lines is on top of the gray lines. I just like it in this case. Fine. So, and the last one was, you can also, yeah, so here too, I'm doing the same thing, enrollment point between the language, but instead of filling by the program type, now I am filling by residence. So you can now see that since we had four residents, it will do for the four for each of the language speaking, I mean, the language variable, okay? And then you also have the across residents also for the Hungarian, okay? So that's how built, you just have to edit. So I only change the field to residents. So you can change to other things, but make sure that the Y can only be numerical variable, but the X and then the field can only be categorical. So don't forget that the Y can be only numerical, okay? But the X, because the Y, you are trying to compare enrollment points, the distribution of enrollment points between the two languages, okay? However, you're also trying to explore across their residents at the same time, okay? So this one gives you a fair idea that technically, those who speak English, okay, technically have higher enrollment points than those who speak Hungarian, okay, Hungarian language, the Hungarian language or Hungary language. I don't know the name of the language anyway. Fine. And don't forget that this line is just the median. This one is actually the 75th quartile. This is actually the 25th quartile. And the end point are the maximum and the minimum point, okay? And then this one, these dots tells the outliers. So this actually tells that, oh, there were some values that were far below. So this gives fair idea about potential outliers that existed. So anytime you see these things, it tells you that there were a bit of outliers. So some group of students enrollment points that were between 350, whilst majority of them or bulk of them were around this range. Okay, so that is that. And the last one, I was also trying to plot two graphs, but this time around I'm doing a line graph. Okay, so I want to look at the linear relationship between total point and enrollment point. And at the same, so I'm doing the same thing, but what I did here was that I was considering two different instances. You realize that technically I could just use ggplot, specify the data name, and then specify x, y, and then whatever. You remember previously when it was categorical, okay? At some point I was using fill, but if I'm doing a line graph, okay, instead of fill, if I want to distinguish, I would rather use I would rather use color equals the math grid, and still group equals math grid. I'm not using fill, okay, because this is a line graph. So if it's a line graph, don't forget that that's it. So now suppose this line graph, if I don't distinguish, because now I'm just looking at a line graph between total points and enrollment, but I wanted to also distinguish between the grades, okay? So that's why I added the group by grades. If I didn't add that, let's see what will happen. So if I should run this, open a new cell. So we are almost done. We have just about 5 minutes more. So if I remove group by, so I can remove color by and group by. Let's see what happens. If I remove color by and group by, whatever, and I run this one. Okay. So clearly now, it's just giving you the linear relationship between total points and a Roman point. And you can see this is just like the linear. It's doing something called smoothing, okay? So the smoothing, I wouldn't want to go much into it, but it's using smoothing method. So the GAM here is actually called generalized additive model, okay? But you don't need to know that. But this one helps you if you want to now know the mean behavior or the mean relationship or the linear relationship between, let's say, two variables, but it's also smoothing and putting some confidence and bound around it for you, okay? But I wanted to do the same thing, but distinguish between the grades, Okay, and that's why I added a fill, and that one will give me three different plots for each of them. And this one can tell you what? It tells us that clearly there's a linear relationship between total points and enrollment across all the categories in terms of the different classes of the mass grade, okay? And it also tells you something that students who had who were in the high class, actually, as their enrollment class was increasing, we know that for all of them, as the enrollment point increases, total point also increases because there's a linear relationship. But you can clearly see that students in the high class actually had higher score in terms of the total point. Okay, they had higher total points than students in the medium, and also students in the medium had higher than those in the low class. So it always depends on what you really want to know. That's what you would plot, okay? And here I was trying to do the smoothening and one without the smoothening. So you realize that without the smoothening, I was using this and I've taken everything out without the smoothening, okay? And I'm still doing across the category. So you realize that in that case, you will get a scatter plot, because if you just plot two numerical variables, okay, you get a scatter plot. But this scatter plot is indeed telling that there's a linear relationship. And then here I was trying to distinguish the plots across these three categories. And that's why it gives me different colors for each of the categories, okay? So it always depends on what you are interested in, all right? And then the last one was I was trying to do a density plot. Don't forget that the density plot is not different from histogram, okay? But so density plot actually tries to give you the distribution and trying to mimic a normal distribution. And it also helps you to know whether your data is skewed, whether to left or right. As you can see here, it can tell you that enrollment points, it's actually skewed more to the left. As you can see, it stretches more to the left. So meaning that a lot of students were literally, there were a lot of marks that were far closer to 300. And here is just telling us the median. It's telling us the mode, sorry. So the mode here, this one gives you a fair idea about the mode, because it meant most of the students were a greater proportion were getting marks enrollment point around here. So this gives you the mode. And if you want to find the median, because it stretches more to the left, the median will be somewhere around here. The median will be somewhere around here for each of the residential status. The median of enrollment points will be somewhere, the mean will be somewhere here. And the median is always the middle. So the mean will be somewhere here. The median will be in the middle. And then the mode is here. And this tells you that the data is negatively skewed or left skewed. That is for enrollment point across all the residential status. At some point, you would prefer this over histogram, because clearly this gives you a lot of information. At the same time, it gives you the distribution. It tells you a little bit about the skewness, a better picture of the skewness, even though histogram can also tell you, right? And then you can clearly see that this also looks a little, just imagine if you now consider, so this is just like histogram, okay? But this time around, you are rather considering a density plot, which is literally trying to mimic a form of normal distribution, okay? So it's technically doing something like a histogram, and it tells the same information as histogram, but this gives extra information about the degree of skewness. And it also helps you to also identify the mode, where the mode will exist for each of them. And then, yeah, it also tells whether the data appear to be normally distributed or not. If the data appear to be normally distributed, we wouldn't expect to see a longer stretch. We would want to see the stretch at the left and the tail to be almost the same. If it stretches more to the right, it is right skewed or positively skewed. If it stretches more to the left, it is left skewed or negatively skewed, okay? And then so it gives you a lot of information. So, and then the last thing that I was talking about was using the package called performance analytics. I told you that if you want to do correlation exploration, trying to assess the relationship that exists among more than let's say two variables at the same time. Don't forget that you cannot find correlation between three variables at the same time. It's always going to do a pairwise correlation. It will pick two at a time. But you can use this plot. It will do two at a time, but across all those possible combinations, okay? So at the end of the day, so if since I had three, only three variables, so here I'm extracting the columns, okay? So here, let me take away this. I wasn't extracting height. I was extracting enrollment point. I was extracting, let me take this out. So I was extracting enrollment point, which is the fourth column. The math point is the sixth column, and the eighth point is the total point. And this is giving you the correlation. Don't forget that there were a lot of zeros. The data was zero inflated. There were a lot of zeros. So that's why you are seeing from the scatter plot, you are seeing a lot of zeros here. Okay, so don't worry about the nature of the data. What I'm trying to imply is that for any data set, you can get a more informative information about the correlation if you use this function or this pack and function from the performance analytics. You can get very nice plots, and then you can also get something more informative, because the leading diagonal is actually the distributions, as you can see. And this is what I said, that the histogram also gives you a fair idea about skewness. So you can see enrollment point is skewed more to the left because it stretches more to the left. And here you realize that we're adding this line, okay? That's why I said it's kind of, so this line is like the density plot we're looking at. So the density plot is like the red line here. So these density plots you are seeing, technically it's like, because this one, I'm not doing it across any category. That's why we have only one information. But the very moment you do it across different categories, you get different, if there are three categories, you get three different information about the distribution, okay? Right, okay. So I've already explained this in the previous video, so I won't go too much into it. And yeah, so I didn't do anything on the base, because for the base, we've already did it in the actual, how do you call it, summary statistical function. We created histogram plot for when it's categorical, and pie chart for when it's categorical, and also histogram for when it's numerical. Basically, and if you look at the second R script, I've already explained how you can do some of the plots without the package, without the ggplot package. But clearly you can see that the ggplot package has more advantages over the normal or the base plots, okay? Because whatever the base plot can do, ggplot package can do better. I mean, that's technically the reality. I mean, the truth is truth. All right, so to summarize what we've done, so basically we're just trying to clarify and also to summarize what we've done in the first two lessons. And at the end of the day, you can go through the assignment task at your own pace, try and go through each of the codes, run it, edit some of the variables, make mistakes. If you get mistakes, just shout and change the variable names, get different plots, and then just keep practicing. Just keep practicing. And don't forget that at this point, if you want to do anything, you can even start with a Google. Just start. Suppose you want to do a time series plot. Once you've imported the data, you can ask, first of all, how to set the data or declare data as time series in R. If you just Google, you will see that they've specified some packages. Once you see library of, let's say, time series, a package called time series, then you install, then you load. After loading, just follow what they are doing, and then follow the set the time as and everything. So by the time you realize, you can actually, from based on this level, you can actually just use Google to even do so many things you want to do, even without my help, okay? So don't forget that the internet is always your friend, and that should be the first point of contact. At this point, once you know how to import the data, you technically don't need anyone. But the only difference is that my summary statistics function, if you didn't know proper programming, there's no way you could have created that, okay? And then programming, a good programmer is not someone who wants to rely on packages. Sometimes you should be able to create your own. Just imagine the summary statistics function we've created. There's no package that can do that. So in such a case, we've created it ourselves to get what we want. So that's the beauty of knowing how to do the programming yourself. And then if you want to do a task which has a package that can easily do that for you, then you don't have to worry yourself to create your own function. Just go and call the package. No one cares whether you use the package or not. Okay, so I'll end here, and then thank you very much for joining the class. And then please don't forget to subscribe to the channel and keep practicing. And for programming, if I were you, I'll try each day about maybe 1 to 2 hours each day to do something on programming, and be Googling, searching for information on something. Right now, we've not done regression. Next week, we'll be starting the inferential statistics. We'll start doing statistical tests the regression. Now we are going to do the model fitting. Okay, that is from next week. Now the model fitting, suppose you want to fit a regression. Now you've imported the data, just Google how to do linear regression in R. Once you Google, you'll be able to get some codes and you can start playing around even before we actually do it. Okay, so don't forget. And also don't forget that when I'm teaching, I also try to teach a bit of the statistics. So it's not just about the programming. Also listen to every statistical concept I also give out, because it's also very useful. Thank you very much. And then I would end here. And if you have any question, you can ask after this class. Thank you very much and see you next week.